Well, it's wonderful to have all of you here today, and especially to have Lynn. For those of you who don't know Lynn, not only is she a friend of mine, but which it's always nice to have friends come and visit you. Lynn is really an extraordinary human being and woman, and actually an extraordinary role model, not just as a woman, but as a human being as well. Lynn is the founder of Patriarch Partners and the sole proprietor, is that the right word? They manage, what, over 75 companies now that is part of Patriarch?
And yeah, well, I'm the owner of 75 separate companies with 120,000 employees that together, this island of misfit toys, which it is, comprises the largest female-owned business in America.
Oh, isn't that extraordinary? People are always better giving their bios than I am. For those of you who don't know me, and I think probably many of you do, my name is Jim Doty. I'm the founder and director of CCARE and a sometimes neurosurgeon. And as part of this conversation on compassion, one of my interests is to meet people. You know, we do have programs for scientists and those whose lives are dedicated in the context of science, medicine, in this field of compassion, but what always fascinates me is people who are not in medicine, but who have really focused their lives on that, and it's not obvious always and clear, and I think you've met some of our other business leaders who I've been an honor or had the honor to host. So Lynn, as you may know, we start this as really truly just a conversation, and I really want to, as we go along, focus on really the compassion side of your life. But I also wanted to talk to you about a little bit about your backstory. I know you're from the Bronx, but maybe you could tell us about what set you on this path and some of the drivers there in your early life.
Well, yes, I am a kid from the Bronx and proud of it, and then grew up in New Jersey, but always came from humble roots. My parents were first generation Americans. And we didn't grow up with money, but we were pushed a lot towards, you know, education and achievement. But my father died when I was 19 as a sophomore at Yale. And that sort of changed my world. I went from being a bit of the golden girl. You know, I played national tennis circuit, was top 10 in the nation, always did well in school. And then all of a sudden, sort of things began to collapse. Because when you lose a working parent, fear sets in. And so that was really a changing point in my life, watching sort of a family fall apart based on the fear of losing someone who was taking care of them. And that set me off to get married when I was 20, have a child when I was 22, and then was a single mother by the time I was 23, where survival was really the noblest of my causes. And I really was split in half, trying to raise a child and work more than 100 hours a week on Wall Street in a very male world.
And it's interesting you bring that up, because it certainly, in that time frame, there were not that many women. And obviously, on some level, you were driven to achieve. And as you mentioned, fear was probably part of that. How did you juggle that, and what were the things that gave you strength during that time? You know, we talk about in terms of compassion this desire to recognize and alleviate the suffering of others, but often that suffering is a manifestation of fear and anxiety.
I don't know if I found much to get me through except love of a child and love of family. And just the feeling that there was no other choice but to keep walking in the darkness, one foot in front of the other until I saw the light. I mean, I really don't remember my 20s. I mean, I worked on Wall Street. I went to business school in 14 months while I was raising a child, went back, and I think the darkness, the sort of only half living, so afraid that I couldn't take care of my child, and so afraid that I'd get fired because I wasn't able to devote the same sort of attention that the unmarried men were able to do, and the expectation that, you know, I would never talk about or have to compromise to take care of my child during that period. And I think that those dark years were such a force in who I became and what I do today. There is no greater debilitating factor than fear. And once you can let go of fear and admit to being an imperfect being, you can sort of spread your wings and begin to walk towards the light.
Well, it's interesting you say that. This challenge that each of us have is, I think you just mentioned, is one is all of us are fearful on some level, and that fear drives us to certain behaviors, but how do we let go? Because oftentimes when you're able to let go of the fear, suddenly things open up.
I think you have to let go of the fear for things to open up. For me, I really went on a spiritual journey in my 30s. And I believe that everything that's happened to me, you know, not in every sketchy detail, but really the major factors that happened to me in my life and events really led me to this point. I think having been extremely talented and had many things go my way in my youth gave me a certain level of confidence and parents who loved me and made me believe that I could do most anything. I think my 20s humbled me. I think, you know, getting beaten and bruised those years and not having an easy time brought me to my knees. I think the spiritual journey of my 30s made me learn to let go of those things that were unimportant and also to see clearly my way of living my life in a place that it was a search for truth, gave me sort of the foundation for my 40s, which has been this journey of, you know, doing what I think is the most important thing that I can do, which is giving people dignity, the dignity of work and the ability to take care of their families.
Let's talk about this spiritual journey, and maybe you can share with us some of your experiences, because many of the people who are here tonight are on their own journey and have had their own difficulties and tribulations, and seen someone who has overcome many difficulties, it's always wonderful to hear a little bit about what allowed them, if you will, to get beyond that and actually see this light.
Well, I think, you know, I really didn't like my life. In my late 20s, I really felt like it didn't have much meaning. I was going to work every day. I didn't especially think that what I did had a lot of meaning. And I was unfulfilled. I mean, I really was worried about my daughter all the time. And for some reason, I took her on a trip to Florida and I stayed. And I cannot tell you why. I mean, I didn't just stay, but I did buy a house on that trip and try to move my life. I played tennis in Florida, you know, growing up a lot, and it just brought, I tried to revert to that which made me happy, you know, the sunshine, the ocean, and playing tennis. And I decided that I was going to raise my daughter in Florida. And I started to commute back and forth to New York because I couldn't earn a living there. And then I was found by a group of Mayan Indians.
Is there anybody else in here who have been found by Mayan Indians?
And you didn't even know this was coming, did you?
No, you told me a little, you hinted at this once before.
So, yeah, I basically didn't know why I bought the house, didn't know why I stayed. And then shortly after, I was, as they said, touched by the spirit. And for all of you who have read Carlos Castaneda, then you understand, because when you've been touched, there is a light to you that those who have the ability are able to see. And from then, it all began to unravel. And I really studied with this group of very old Mayans for the better part of a decade. And during that period, I prepared to sort of get out of what I was doing, and really working each day and doing what I did was part of my exit, just saving enough money and getting my daughter through high school so that I could go live a very solitary and spiritual life. And I do come from a line of Kabbalist scholars, so I don't know anyone who has studied the Kabbalah at all, but my father's bloodline is the Baal Shem Tov. So I've always had the ability to see. I mean, when I was a kid, all I had to say to someone in my family is, how do you feel? And they'd be like, well, what do you know? You know, it was one of those. But once I got out of my childhood years and life got complex and you get beaten down, I sort of lost that power or that magic. But this journey brought it back to me. And then I really started to study every spiritual body that I could get my hands on, whether the Kabbalah, whether it was sort of the Mayan sorcery, Taoism, you know, Buddhism, the teachings of Jesus Christ, to see how they all melded together. And really what I realized was that it came down to, you know, do the words and actions of that I take part in each day create light in the world, or do they create darkness? And I do business all over the world. I sell aircraft to the Saudis and to the Jordanians, and I'm in India and I'm in China. And I can speak to everyone when I speak in terms of dark and light and good and evil, because it's something that we all understand. And the one thing that people don't really understand is that enlightenment is the search for truth. Which that means it's unraveling things, peeling away each layer of the onion until you can hold that core in your hand. And frankly, it's exactly how I do business, is tearing everything apart until you're down to its basic variables. When you talk about businesses, they really are the confluence of the qualitative and the quantitative. And the quantitative side is really easy. It's just numbers. It's cash in, cash out. And it's down to every product, every color, you know, every shape. You have to understand it, the cash that comes in and the expenses toward that product that goes out. But it's the qualitative side of how do you understand a business? And the best way for me to describe it is as a tapestry of threads, that you have to begin to peel apart thread by thread so that you can get rid of the off-colored and the tattered and find those strong threads to work around. And so the search for enlightenment is really the search for truth. It's about digging deeper and deeper and deeper until you're down at the basic variables. And so that's the way I live my life, and I speak the truth, and I have the courage to hear the truth even when it's painful, because in the end, you can't change the world or make a difference if you're trying to be popular. You can only be a change agent if you're willing to put truth out there to individuals, to groups, and in your words to the world.
You know, it's interesting you say that. You know, sometimes people, when we use the term compassion, they think of it as sort of this mamby-pamby talk that doesn't address issues or doesn't deal with reality, but we try and make everybody feel okay. And that's not what compassion is at all.
Compassion is giving people what they need in a moment. And, you know, I think compassion is contagious, and, you know, I have used, as I'm out there speaking to people and my companies, I've often used, you know, your study of the brain. People don't believe me that they're going to feel as good about giving as they do about having sex, but I keep trying to push that.
In my experience, and I keep testing this every day.
But the truth is that compassion is giving to someone what they need in the moment. And most of the time we think about those who are in the worst possible moment and giving them hope and light to pick them up. And that is a very powerful form of compassion. But sometimes when someone's on the wrong path, having the courage to tell them something they don't want to hear and knowing that they might walk in a different direction and you might lose a friend or a student or someone you love, that's compassion too.
Obviously, you're an extraordinarily successful businesswoman, and I know that there is a mission behind this. And I know that both in your early time on Wall Street, but later it was looking at companies in distress, and how has that aspect and really being able to evaluate a distressed company, but then also deconstructing that to figure out what is the true value, what is there, and also this mission of giving people dignity and recognizing the importance of supporting people who contribute so much to a business.
I will tell you that my early years on Wall Street were not about a mission. I mean, when I was graduating from Yale, I said to people, what kind of jobs pay the most? I mean, all I'd really done was play tennis, and now I had huge responsibility, and everybody said, you know, these Wall Street jobs are the hardest to get and they pay the most, and get into any business school you want. And I interviewed as an English major, and they could see very much that I was someone who was a perfectionist and they could work me to death. And that's how my entry into Wall Street was. But when I had gone through the spiritual journey and really had prepared to retire, there was a moment where I had a calling and I had to come back to the world and figure out how I would make the world a better place. And so I had to look at what I knew, what my experience was, and try to find that pathway. And I had bought companies, I had done leverage buyouts with companies, and I had worked with distressed companies. And I realized that my mission should be to sort of heal the wound within me, which was the dignity of work, seeing how families fell apart when they lost a working parent, either to death or to joblessness. And so I realized that if I bought companies that everybody else left for dead, and I rebuilt them, that no one could argue that that was value added, because of course I wanted to find my worth, right? And that every time I saved someone from going home to tell their family they could no longer care for them, that that would be my creating a little bit of light in the world. And so that's how this all began. Then, of course, I created a financial model that's patented that allowed me to raise the money to do this, but it almost became a mission of a maniac, right? This savior syndrome that I now found this way that I could buy these companies and stand in front of these groups of people and say, not today. You know, not today do you have to face your family and the indignity of not being able to care for them. I didn't think out very clearly what that meant as I piled on all these companies and then had to figure out a way to take what everyone else thought couldn't be saved and save it. And so it has been an evolutionary process, and I am definitely an imperfect being, and I have made many mistakes along the way and haven't been able to save everything, but I have owned 150 companies in the last 13 years, and I have saved 250,000 jobs, of which I'm very proud of, but the journey's not over yet, and the storybook has not ended, and the game gets much more difficult every day.
Obviously, you are intimately familiar with Wall Street. I'm sure you follow the various financial debacles that have occurred. What is your sense of what is really going on there. Are these self created wounds to the financial markets based on greed and selfishness? Do we really need to look at a different economic model? Is the structure, and I'm saying all of this because we're at a business school, so I...
And I'm trying to keep track of all these questions.
Yeah. Is there a better way than the way that business has been done in your view, since clearly you look at things in a different way and have been extraordinarily successful?
Look, I think making money and making the world a better place are not mutually exclusive options. And I do not believe that in the greater greed theory, you know, that as long as you're doing what's right to make the most money for yourself, that everything else will follow. Capitalism with ethics is an amazing force that drives an economy and puts people to work and allows people to follow. Capitalism absent ethics is as dangerous as capitalism with ethics is, you know, a path towards prosperity for many. So I think the biggest issue is this feeling of my fiduciary responsibility is to make money for my shareholders, and it does not matter what else I do along the way. I think we have also lost sort of a value system in this country. It's more about what I can get away with than what's right and wrong. And I have to tell you that I don't think there's any gray area. I think there is only light and dark and right and wrong. And I think the minute you step in that gray world, or you think it's okay, that you're glued to a place where you'll never get out of it. You know, you cannot let yourself go. And I'm grateful that before I came back to do this, that I had gone through this spiritual awakening, because I'm not sure I would have been prepared to have so much money go through my fingers and never make a mistake of integrity. I make plenty of mistakes of investment, but I don't make mistakes of integrity. And as you get very successful, you become a very big target for lawsuits and investigations and everything else. And neither would I have had the strength to deal with the battles, nor would I probably have had the integrity sufficiently pure to never have to worry one second about what I've done in terms of having to sort of fight for my innocence on a daily basis.
Do you, obviously you run across a lot of people, a lot of fellow business people. Do you think that's their worldview?
No.
In the majority?
No. No, I mean, you know, look, and a lot of people, you know, pass judgment upon me and think I'm, you know, crazy. And no, I think that it's accepted to drive for profitability at the cost of all else.
You know, it's interesting. I don't know if you any of you saw this. There was a very large hedge fund named after an individual, and I think 8 of his major traders have already been convicted of financial crimes. And it was fascinating. The most recent person who's now on trial is a guy who was thrown out of Harvard Law School for falsifying his grades by going into the computers. Now, how could, I mean, in a real world, this person would have been thrown out and never allowed, or certainly there would have to be a long road to redemption. How could this organization hire this person?
Well, we also live in a litigious world where no one talks about what someone's done wrong. I mean, you keep hiring the same bad people absent of ethics, because when you call someone, all they'll say is, yes, they went to school here, or yes, they worked during this period. We're now so afraid of litigation that you can be a CFO and steal and be a CFO again. There, people aren't held accountable to value systems, and there isn't the same sort of consequences for bad behavior. I could bless an entire third world country with the amount of money that has been stolen from me. I mean, I don't want you to think that I am sort of not sufficiently evolved that I don't get stolen from all the time. You know, there are a lot of bad people. And, you know, as the Baal Shem Tov says, what we dislike in others most is what we dislike in ourselves. But what we don't have in ourselves, we often won't see coming at us. Now, at this point, I should be a lot less naive because I'm supposed to learn from the pain and the scars of what has been done to me. But look, I have 75 companies around the world with 120,000 employees. I can't babysit at every level. But working hard and taking a pathway where you're walking towards the light every day does not bring the same instant gratification than taking a path of darkness where you just take what you want. And it used to be that intellectual honesty always won, and walking towards the light always brought the best result. And I think lately we've lived in a world that hasn't had that balance, where darkness really has allowed people to be the winner. And I think that the only way that changes is if we change it together, because, you know, people are just matter. We're all just energy. And the only way you change the direction of an enveloping darkness is with the power of light, which means the greatest force of nature is people standing shoulder to shoulder and moving in the same direction. So if you don't like what you see, then be the change you want. I know I'm quoting someone important. I'm a little off, but Gandhi's okay.
Yeah. Well, it's interesting because I think that gets back to one of the issues which we've sort of a little bit addressed, is that, you know, one of the anxieties you talked about in yourself was this issue of raising your child. And I think what happens to some people is they get in a position where they have certain responsibilities, let's say to a family, a children or whatever, but then they get in these situations where they're not unhappy or they're seeing bad things being done, and not that they actively participate, but at the same time they're fearful of being a whistleblower, or if you will, being a hero or standing out there, because oftentimes that comes at a cost. And for many people, that cost, they have a perception that that will devastate them and potentially destroy their ability to care for their family. Do you have any?
Look, I think it's very understandable. I think what's not under, you know, not speaking out, it, you know, is one thing. Participating is another too. So I think there are different sort of errors in judgment. I know what it's like to be afraid and be afraid to lose your job, but there's nothing that would have made me cross the line. And you always have the option to leave. You know, it's, you know, if you're a whistleblower, you will often be hurt for that, and that takes tremendous courage. But participating because you feel like you have to, I don't know. I don't think you can ever make excuses for that. You always have the option to go somewhere else. You can't cross the line, because the minute you do, there is no redemption.
Well, I would like to disagree with you slightly that I hope there's some redemption or the possibility of redemption.
I didn't mean it that way. I meant for the deed.
Yeah, no, no.
You know, absolution rather than redemption. How's that?
We're going to head off into the Bible here shortly, so the Kabbalah. But no, I think that's right. And you know, the sad thing is that in our society, as you were just talking about, people are rewarded for these incredible transgressions, and it's like somehow okay now. And whether, I don't know if this is a manifestation of celebrity, or, you know, we see these reality shows where there are people who are highlighted in these reality shows that, frankly, are some of the most despicable people and role models that you can even imagine, yet this is what we're showing to even children. You know, children get into these things. You know, one of the things that I find fascinating, we have so many children and young people who are fascinated by Justin Bieber or some of these other people, and I didn't mean to pick him out, as he's certainly not the worst in any way, but people who, you know, we're not highlighting the success of people overcome incredible adversity or people who are in socioeconomically disadvantaged areas doing incredible work, or things, these are not being highlighted as our hero.
I think that's the media. And I think that it's what sort of the media thinks it, you know, people are drawn to. And I'm hoping that that's changing. But the things that scare me most is when the number one YouTube video is two girls, you know, beating each other up or bullying, or when that whole knockout sort of posting and phase where people were knocking out, you know, 76-year-old women walking down the street. That scares me, because if that is enjoyable to people, there's such pain and such anger within them. You can't enjoy that unless you're trying to assuage some deep, you know, darkness within you that it releases and makes you feel better. We need to make people feel better by seeing things that are behaviors to emulate. And I was telling you earlier how I spent December running around the country doing makeovers for battered women. Because for me, you know, I think about dignity as the gift. And I can't think more where dignity has been stripped away is when someone has been, you know, in a subservient position without power, being knocked around by someone they think they love. And so I had relaunched an old brand name, an old Estee Lauder makeup company called Jane Cosmetics that had been off the shelves for a while. And because I'm tired, and I don't think I can do much more in terms of buying more companies and saving more jobs, I want my brands to begin to speak from my heart. And so I decided that this would be a philanthropic brand, in that it would buy one and give one to a neighbor in need, to try to create community again in this country, and just women being kind to other women. And so when you buy one in a store, we give one to a shelter for battered women in your community. So you really know where it's going. It's not going across country. There's nothing coming out of it. It's part of my cost of goods sold. You buy one, we give one. But to launch it, I decided over the holidays to go to six shelters across the country with my cosmetics companies, my clothing company, and a new hair care line that I'm launching with a very famous hairdresser named Ken Pavis from Beverly Hills. And we went around, and in each place we took about 40 women and put on, you know, gave them wigs and clothing and makeup, but most important, made them feel like models, like celebrities. And I started by telling them that, you know, what you see here today is not what I was, and that I understand what it's like to feel that the world is so dark that you'll never get through this moment, and that you will get through this moment. And that, you know, I was, you know, a single mother at 23 and afraid, and that part of it is just knowing that you'll find your way. But also to feel so beautiful in a moment that you understand that people should treat you with dignity. And that to remember that moment and never allow anyone to treat them with less dignity than they feel in that moment. And I will tell you that it was such an emotional experience. And everyone who traveled with me and in different places, I had different teams of people, really thanked me for the opportunity to be part of giving, watching these women who, with heads down, dance and come alive and joke. And for these women, it was a changing moment in their life just to be cared for so much. And they all left with, you know, their hair and their makeup and their clothes. And I've gotten a lot of letters from a lot of women in that this was a changing point in their life. But there is a high that comes from being compassionate. And if we could only learn and try a little bit harder to be better people, I think things would change.
Well, I think that's absolutely correct. And I think that's the reality is that when there is a demand or an expectation of, let's say, certain behaviors in regard to ethical behavior, and that this is expected, these are the parameters, and not take the most base, easy way out. And I think people really like that, and they will live up to the expectation if you set that as the bar and not go the easy way, which is to deal with the most base type of activities, which you know you will get a response, but it's certainly not a good response, but it is a response.
I think the problem is that when people don't follow the rules, and you do, and you lose, that even people with high value systems ultimately feel that there's no reward. And so it's very hard for people, unless they are so evolved, to really hold on to that and understand that they're, you know, that to thine own self be true, that they're going to behave in a way that they think is appropriate and enlightened regardless of the consequence. And I think that's how dark forces win. If people who are good people with good values continue to knock their heads into the wall because they try to walk a path towards the light while others look for the instant gratification, and they are at least seemingly rewarded in the short term, people very quickly give up.
Well, I think that's one of our difficulties with our own psychology and evolution is that, you know, evolution, of course, is a very, very slow incremental process, and we have sort of residuals of our evolution. And one is a desire for instant gratification. It's much harder to wait for reward. And in fact, there are some studies that have been done in children that show that if you show even small children, give them the opportunity to either wait for a double reward, if you will, versus grabbing something right now, a lot of them will grab that thing to get that instant gratification. But if you look at long-term results, those children who are a little bit more patient, I wasn't one of those, they actually succeed in life because life is one of having to wait. But the other side of it is this issue of fear and anxiety, because that is a primitive part of our brain that is still there. I was just going to give you an example of my own of talking about people who, you know, events happen and you have to maintain your integrity and not be afraid of that. And as you said, none of us are perfect. And I will tell you an incident of my own as a neurosurgeon where I had taken care of a patient who required back surgery. And, you know, there's a process we do to confirm level in the operating room. And I did that. And in fact, it operated at the wrong level. Now, this is embarrassing and horrible, right? And I didn't know it at the time. And the woman didn't get any better. And ultimately, because she didn't get better, I restudied her and found out that, in fact, I had operated at the wrong level. Now, my response was to call her up immediately, tell her, and tell the appropriate bodies. I mean, instantaneously, no question.
The lawyers, however.
No, I called all
did?
Of them.
Okay.
No, this is not hidden. The lawyers, everybody. And when something like this happens, or something, they do a root cause analysis to figure out, was there a process that went wrong? And I met before a bunch of people. Now, I will tell you, 78% of doctors who do this type of surgery operate at the wrong level at some point in their lives. So I went to this committee. I said, there's no root cause. I was the cause. There's an error on my part. I can't tell exactly what it is, but there is no process. There's nothing going on here. This is my fault, period. I take full responsibility. The head of the committee goes to me and goes, I've been doing this for 20 years. I have never seen a doctor say this. Can you imagine? This is part of the problem, where you don't own up, you don't accept responsibility. And I will also tell you that, amazingly, I probably see 2 to 3 patients a year who've been operated at the wrong level, who haven't gotten better and they're seeking another opinion. I have yet to see a single doctor having told them that they operate at the wrong level. Yeah, so this is part of problem. One is this fear that if you stand up and say, I'm a human being, I'm frail, I make mistakes, I made a mistake, I had good intention, I was wrong, that somehow something horrible is going to happen to you. And maybe sometimes it might. I don't believe that, but this is one of the challenges, is how do you maintain your integrity? How do you not go off and do these things, especially when you see others get away with it, right? And it is hard.
I think once you can admit to being an imperfect being, there's such a weight lifted off your shoulders. I mean, I've struggled my whole life trying to be perfect, and that hasn't gone away. I mean, that is, you know, a problem for me, and that I'm always competing with my own potential, and I want to be a perfect being. That said, I know very clearly that I am an imperfect being, and I can admit it, and certainly my record shows it. But what I do try to do is be imperfect of behavior, not of intent, because I think you can be perfect in your intention. And the other is to really learn from my imperfections. But the beauty to leadership is, it is your fault. I mean, as a true leader, you need to know that no matter what anyone has done, that you are the one who is in control. And I will tell you today, I had to call an insurance company and say, you know, something went wrong, you know, with something. And I said, you know, I can give you different excuses. It wasn't under my watch. It wasn't. But in the end, it's on me. I am the top of the food chain. That means it all rolls uphill. And therefore, there's really no place to turn. You can change out people. You can change process. You can try to do it differently. But no matter what happens under my watch, it's on me. And if you don't do that, then you don't evolve. And the most important part of leadership is, you know, self-evolution and revelation. You have to take a good look in the mirror every day when something goes wrong, and it starts with you.
And, you know, it's interesting because I think that's the most important lesson you can learn as a human being is, you know, some people think, and I think even you and I have talked about this previously, we spend so much energy trying to give this projection of perfection, right? When we meet somebody who we don't know, especially, we want to show them that we're have our act together, that we're successful, that we're not fearful or anxious, and we spend so much energy. But in fact, that's the thing that separates us, because, you know, I there was a wonderful quote, which I'm going to screw up, but it said something along that I spend so much of my time trying to be like the person who is projecting what they think they wish to be, in the sense that, you know, we're trying to live up to the other person's projection instead of saying, you know, I'm a frail, fragile human being. I've messed up, I'm not perfect, and I will need your help at some point. I will give you help. And this is when we talk about dignity, even as leaders and business leaders, and I think you'll agree, is, you know, there's a tendency of some people to, when they have that type of an interaction, let's say with an employee or a subordinate, it's, I'm here, you're there, there's this hierarchy. But the only way you can preserve a person's dignity is if you're seen eye to eye as a human being. And I think that's...
I think you have to bring yourself to everyone's level. And I think whenever you have a tough message to deliver, you know, and you have to take someone down, you also have to bring them back up afterwards. You know, I often have to give people sort of criticism that they don't want to hear because I need them to get better or I need to dismiss them. But you always have to find a balance. You always have to find something good to give someone the courage back to get back up and to fight. So I think that's the important thing. And look, we all have been in tough places before. And I think you don't have to necessarily say we're on the same level, but you have to let people know you've been at that level, because you still do need to have people understand the difference, because sometimes I don't, and that's a problem for me. Well, little respect and appreciation is due.
I think we're slightly talking about two different things, but yeah, no, you're absolutely correct. Let's talk about something else I think that is challenging. I think when you've spent the effort to gain insights into yourself and some of the issues that you've even alluded to about your own imperfections, but being, if you will, a high-powered business person who takes on difficult challenges, oftentimes one doesn't nurture themselves. See, look at this look on her face here.
I breach that rule.
And so...
I don't nurture myself. And that's a problem. And I think that I'm so frightened of letting something fall. And I feel so responsible for so many that I am constantly running to the crisis. And the only way that I sort of try to find any kind of real balance, because I really do work at least 18 hours a day, 7 days a week, is I do try to have laughter in my life. You know, if I can't laugh with the people that I work with and find a way to offset the chaos and crisis, which is my existence, that's really difficult on me. And I need to be alone. I need to find time just to be without people pulling at me. You know, I feel like all day it's, you know, and so I'm such an introvert by nature, and I have so little time to myself that I need to do that. And I try to work out, but other than that, I really have very little time for myself. And it hurts me. It hurts me in my ability to sort of see and to know and to pull at that which is offered to me in terms of knowledge and information. And yet I can't always find that balance because I'm so afraid that if I'm not doing it, something will collapse so deeply that it'll take so much more of me. But when you do not nurture yourself, you lose out on a little bit of what you might be able to take in. And I know that I have that difficulty.
So how are we going to change that?
I guess I'm going to come recruit at Stanford and get some good people to try to help me. You know, I think if I've failed at one thing as I built this business, because it really is a bit of a miracle in what I've been able to build and accomplish over the last 13 years, and I do think it was destined, and that, you know, God or the spirit or higher power you believe in has sort of given me great gifts because I am giving back. And if I ever made this about me, I would lose it. But I didn't build the infrastructure around me that I needed. You know, my world is a world of burnout. I mean, literally, it is the confluence of a trauma center and an orphanage. There's always bleeding, and there's always a child in need. And literally, there's no Christmas Day, there's no New Year's, and the only thing that people have worked for me said that I've lived true to is the promise that they'd never be bored 1 minute in my life. But I lose a lot of my great people to burnout because the people who care the most and care about me the most give me the most, and at some point, you're always in a crisis. Even when there are a lot of great things, there's always a lot of crisis. Sometimes it just really beats people down. But when I was thrown out into the world, I was told never to be sort of at the tip, to always be surrounded by a group of people that would sort of protect me as I walked sort of this path. And yet I found that I was able to build things so quickly because people, I thought it turned
out. Who was that? Oh. This is my old ringtone. I really like it, actually.
Got me moving.
Yeah. We're going to be dancing in a minute.
That I should not be a target, you know, right out front and center. But because I found that people were drawn to me, that if I put myself out front and center, I got deals done. I got, you know, people came to work for me, deals got done. And so I used sort of that force of light and that warrior sensibility to sort of get things done very quickly. But there's a consequence to that, is that I've sort of done this alone, with different people helping me at time, but never really having that strong inner circle, and it has made me a target that people can get to very quickly. And it has not given me quite the foundation for something this big. And it is so big. I didn't think about it as I was going. And as we talked earlier, it's not the game it once was. It used to be the art of restructure, and now it's the art of reinvention. You know, being smart about business only is breathing room, and then it's about really product, technology, innovation every minute of every day. If you're not on the cutting edge, revenues fall, expense structures go. So everything has to be reinvented, both in terms of product and process, which means it's a lot more work, and there are very few people who know how to do it.
You know, it's interesting. Do any of you know Paul Ekman? The emotions.
Lie to me? The lie to
yeah, 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 exactly. Okay. So yeah. Paul Ekman's a good friend of mine. So, and of course, for those who may not know him, he's probably one of the world's most famous psychologists. He'll tell you that. No, I'm just kidding.
Well, if he's anything like the character in Lie to Me, he would.
Yeah. Anyway, he's a dear friend of mine, and he's involved with some of our work. But I was having dinner with him the other night, and I was telling him a story, and I actually got emotional and became tearful, which for any of you that know me, that's like every day. My wife will say I'll cry at Lassie, so which is okay too. But and not having a fear of showing your own vulnerability, I think, is important. But anyway, we're having this dinner, and I told him some story, and he saw that I became emotional. So he sends me this note the next day, and he goes, geez, Jim, it's one of the few times we've really spent alone and spent time together. I'm a little bit concerned that you show, this emotion at such a physical level. And he said, you could burn out. And I sent him a note back. I said, Paul, I've been a doctor for 30 years, a neurosurgeon for 25 years. I've been involved in all these different things. I think if I was going to burn out, it probably would have manifested itself probably by now. But, we do, and again, getting back to what you were saying, sometimes I do find that I don't nurture myself. And I think that that's not a good thing. And I think it is always good to self-reflect, because there are generally around, at least myself and I think you too, there are people who are very concerned for you and who want to protect you because they know you're doing a lot of stuff and that it's hard. And so I think at the same time, though, oftentimes we create systems that we don't necessarily burn out, but frankly, the problem is we have to sit there and really think about why we are doing this, because sometimes is it because we don't want to face certain issues of our own pain, and therefore we do all these other things to distract us. So I give that as a piece of insight, which I won't take this advice, but I just simply give it to you to take.
I think many of us are on a search to be worthy.
Yes, yeah, I think that's exactly right. And that's exactly
and
right.
And we find worth in giving to others and self-sacrifice. I'm the deprivation queen.
And it's interesting because on the one hand, you look at Lynn or perhaps myself and you say, boy, these guys, they're in these different positions, they've accomplished different things. I'm so envious. But the reality is, no matter who you are a human being who has all the same problems and issues and complexities and failures and anxieties and insecurities and et cetera, et cetera, except maybe George Clooney, perhaps. So.
I just cared how my hair would look tonight.
This is the Lynn that I know.
Every
time I see Lynn, she looks absolutely beautiful, so I don't believe a word of this. I think we're going to shift over to maybe have a few questions from people. Does anybody have?
I know I've got questions out
here. Yeah, we're going to ask you questions too. How she's viewed the ethics of competition?
I think it's just that, first of all, I frankly don't spend a lot of time looking at what other people do, but that's not correct in business. One should look at, but I think it's how you compete. If you compete by constantly making yourself better or your company better and innovating and going versus trying to put down or hurt the others, then competition's healthy, because all it is people pushing each other to evolve and be better. So, you know, I have seven operating companies that I'm actually the CEO of, on top of being the director and owner of the other 68. And so I run our automotive platform. As I said, I'm running right to Detroit after this because it's the week of the auto show, and I have a $2 billion automotive parts supplier. But my first company that I ran, and that is probably my true love, is an aerospace company. I own the old Howard Hughes helicopter, MD helicopter company. And when I bought that in 2005, it was shuttered. I mean, done. No manufacturing line, no supply chain, 365 grounded aircraft, and I was too stupid to know what I was doing, truthfully. Everyone walked away from it, even though it was great products, because it was an impossible journey. And I ended up coming in after three management teams to say that before I was going to write off $200 million, I was going to figure out if it really was impossible. And that's how I learned to be an operator and a much better businesswoman and leader. But that is the ugliest world of competition I've ever seen. You know, I compete against Boeing and Bell, which is Textron, and Eurocopter, which is Airbus, you know, Eads, and you know, Boeing, which is an $80 billion company, who I had to beat in a big lawsuit this year trying to hurt my company. And because there are such barriers to entry and there are so few players, it's ugly and it's defense and it's dirty. I don't really give a f- what anyone else is doing. I'm constantly trying to look at my customers and what the needs are and what the white space is and how to evolve and how to innovate in both products and process. And when people, when I sit with customers and they ask me about others, I was like, I can't tell you which helicopter to love or to buy. I can only tell you about how I will treat you and how you will be maintained if you love the product that I have. So I don't try to compete by taking anyone else down. I try to compete by taking what I have up. And I think that's where, you know, ethics don't even come into the game. If I have to try to badmouth someone else or point out their defects to get my prospect, then I have a problem.
Just to, as a point of note, actually, Lynn is going to be inducted into the Aviation Hall of Fame, which is a very exclusive group of people. How many are in it? Less than 50?
They only have 50 at any given time, yeah. So actually someone has to pass away to get in.
But she did. She was not responsible for that.
No, I didn't. You know. I didn't wish it on anyone. Actually, last year when I was supposed to be inducted into, it's called the Hall of Fame for Living Legends of Aviation, I didn't show up. So this year, so that's how much I wasn't wishing it on anyone. But I had been the entrepreneur, first female entrepreneur of the year a couple of years ago, and would have been inducted then, but there was not an opening. So this year, I think John Glenn left an opening. Because it's really the greatest aviators, and then certain celebrities, Hollywood celebrities like John Travolta and Harrison Ford and Morgan Freeman, and then very few business people that have done extraordinary things in the industry.
So congratulations.
Thank you.
We have time for a few more questions. This young lady in the far back.
Thank you. Hi, it's on. Lynn, appreciate your time. You have such an incredible energy and presence up there and a really unique viewpoint. And my ears really perked up when you mentioned about sort of being a little bit not tired exactly with this current, but it got me curious about what you see that might be next for you. And in particular, whether it might involve writing or spiritual leadership, kind of borrowing on your Kabbalah scholar roots.
You know, I'm a poet by background. I actually am a writer. And if you'd asked me what I would have done getting out of school, I always had wanted to write. So this has been sort of a detour. You know, I think that I will just let the path open. I have a long journey yet because I still have a lot of people to take care of and get these companies built and put back out in the world, because with technology, there's a lot of changes to come. I do believe that this is a first act, that I think that I have sort of achieve this wealth and success as a credibility issue, but I have no clue what that might be. And if it's solitary soul riding on an island somewhere, that's good enough for me. But I think that my life does not belong to me. I think that I am walking a path that was paved for me and many gifts were given to me so that I could walk this path. And I've gotten pretty used to letting that pathway open up. But I expect that I will write a book. I've been asked to write a book so many times, and yet I don't want someone else to write it for me because the power of words is sort of my greatest love and my ability to put pen to paper as any pain poet usually can is my greatest asset. So I'd like to do it myself.
Yes, sir.
I was wondering about sort of a practical question in terms of applying these ideas for your own employees and so forth. And in particular, I was wondering what you do that might be different to support employees that have their own sort of care issues, whether caring for elderly or children or so forth, which is a challenge for people that are working and have family caregiving responsibilities. And again, just wondering what you might be doing that's more enlightened than other companies.
I'm probably not more enlightened. I mean, look, I was a single mother, and so I certainly understand it. But I also have companies where, you know, if we don't do what we need to do, everybody loses. You know, I worry about my loyalty to company, which is my loyalty to everyone. And I frankly don't have a world that can be beneficent in terms of letting people not come to work each day or to stay at home and work from home. I mean, on occasion, but in general, my world is you've had something crashing and now you've got to turn the energy. So I've got to change that propensity of flow, which takes so much energy. I can't do that without people. I can give people the dignity of work. I can save their companies. I can't be the one who's giving them the ability to work from home or do it. And look, I think it's great when companies can, but if I do that, then everybody else loses. So I am probably not the most generous in terms of letting people have their ability not to work hard. I think, you know, my theory on employment is Lincoln freed the slaves. You know, people don't have to work for me. But if they do come to work for me, they have to work for a loyalty to the entire company, to everyone around them. They need to care as much about them as they do about their own lives, or I'll never win. And it's not that I don't think it's right to do it differently. I just can't and support everyone because I'm trying to do the impossible. So I can't take credit for that goodness. I really can't. In believing that you're destined for something, it gives you sort of the courage and the confidence that you'll be able to do something different. I don't have the proper fear factors. I've sort of promised myself I would never be afraid again after being afraid, and there are a number of countries I've been kicked out of because I don't sort of let fear ever stand in the way of what I do. I think I also am able to learn much more quickly, sort of inhale information, and I have a belief that whatever's in front of me, I'll figure my way out of. And I do think that sort of clearing my mind and my spirit has allowed me that. I never felt that I had the sort of gift of intellect growing up and through my early life that I feel like I have now. I feel like something changed. That my ability to know things and learn things and be a solution provider sort of accelerated at a pace that I never thought was possible. And so, yes, I think this spiritual awakening and what I was able to let go of and my ability to sort of let go a lot of those things that are damaging. Vanity I have not let go of, as I made clear earlier, but fear and anger and ego and selfishness. I think that has allowed me to pull in other things as there's a balance to the universe. I think starting each day from a place of appreciation rather than expectation. I think appreciation is the one emotion to which there is no counterbalance. You know, if we wake up each day and we're appreciative for all those things we have, and you basically start with the cup half full, right? And I think being a single mother was the most defining force in my life. And so in everything, there's a power that comes from every sacrifice. And I think the most important thing to remember, and I need to remind myself too at times, is that there truly is a balance to the universe. And for that which we sort of lose, there's always opportunity. But so many of us get beaten down by the pain of loss or the frustration or the beatings that we have the tendency not to look up and see the opportunity that's granted. And so I try to remember always, as I'm, you know, dealing with battle and beatings, to remember to look up. And I think that we have to believe in the balance of the universe.
Compassion could play a role in creating an innovative and creative climate in a company.
Compassion, innovation, survival. Well, I think that compassion as a driving force within a company could absolutely create an energetic that would be very helpful to a company. Because I think that, you know, when people ask me what would change the world most, I say that if people woke up each day and they thought of someone other than themselves and their family as a driving force, you'd get that 100th monkey, right? Everyone moving in the same direction towards compassion as a contagious energy. But in terms of a business, you can do compassion, but if you don't have a product to sell or you've rendered yourself irrelevant, I'm not sure that that alone can be the only innovation. Do I think if you could get everyone in a company as you're moving that company forward to have compassion as a driving force in their life and therefore as an energetic of the company, I think that could create a great power because people would be moving in the same direction, and that's a powerful force.
I think on that note, I think we have to call it an evening. Thank you all so much, Lynn. It is truly a pleasure. And thank you again, everyone. Thank you.